Before we start, first off, anyone want to tell us how the Dax Guy evening went?
Yeah, it was quite good.
Oh, good!
In the art evening from 5 o'clock right through to about half eight.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually fairly good.
Somebody left the brown cat down in the space room. Oh, it's yours, I think.
Then it fogged over.
Okay, no, we were wondering because it was fogged up at our place and also foggy up north too. So we're just wondering whether or not you got some fog up down south.
Yeah, we did. Kawakawa Bay, we did get a little bit.
Okay.
It was cleared up when I left Blockhouse Bay. It was foggy when I got to Watson Road. It was pretty well clear.
Okay.
And then across the Harbour Bridge, which is Manukau Harbour, It was foggy and clear after that, all the way through Manukau and right through to Kawakawa Bay.
Okay.
Then half past eight, quarter to nine, it was all fogged up on the Kawakawa Bay hills and stuff like that. Very, very foggy.
Okay, so it looks like fog was all over the place. Okay, the reason I asked is if anyone was out there taking pictures, is it the Harry Williams Trophy? Oh, my brain's gone.
Yes, there was one of them, taking a few photos.
Yeah, well, let me put it this way. The competition closes, the entries are due in by the end of August. So for the photographic competition, which surprise will be announced at the Burbage dinner. Who's the judge? Phil Platt, or was that last year?
That was last year. Damien Pictures.
Last year. Okay. And also, I've got a question for you. Is anyone going to America for the solar eclipse in Auckland? Okay. Whereabouts are you going to try seeing it?
Hopkinsville, Kentucky.
Okay. Yeah. I was hoping to meet up with a group in Idaho, but I don't think it's going to happen. Especially when they decided that. Where are you going?
You said you were going as well?
Yeah. I'm planning to go to Wyoming.
I'm just wondering if anyone knows of any astronomical societies over there or is planning special tours or something.
Anyway. It's going to be a huge event in a lot of places.
I've already checked out accommodation around Idaho, and that's all booked out.
Yeah, if you haven't got accommodation, you're probably not going to get accommodation.
It's
extraordinary.
Either that or be hosting we'll be having a show about it. Anyway. Enough about that. Sean Fletcher, planetary imaging, or at least a workshop, you call it. So.
Workshop / talk / conversation.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, we'll see what we've got time to do.
Go for it.
What I'm going to do is, I'm going to run through the electrical PowerPoint slideshow, explain what it is I do, what the basic stuff involved is, and then some of the detailed steps. There's some videos that I took them up, but I don't know when we'll go with those. And then I have actually got a couple of videos from the camera here, which we could run. If we've got time, I could run through the program and actually the process on screen just so we can see how it goes. So, amateur planetary imaging is now accessible in a way it's never been before, as you all know from the images you see on the internet. These are mine. These are pretty basic equipment. I'm pretty pleased to be able to get this kind of result for a home telescope. An 8-inch telescope at home, so it's come up pretty well. There's obviously Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. The easiest three planets to image, apart from the Earth, of course. And the Moon is extremely simple as well. Everything else gets more challenging. Venus is quite easy to image, but if you've got a location where you can see it, but you don't actually see very much. You see like shape, but anyway. So, we'll start off by talking about what is it, why, and what does it cost, and can I do it? The first answer is what do? I use a video camera and telescope to produce mathematically stacked images of solar system objects. Why do I do it? Because it's something you can do when the moon's up and when you haven't got time for an 8-hour imaging session and all these things. That's essentially why it's actually, in a way, it's a sort of second string astrophotography to me in comparison to deep sky astrophotography, but you know, you can do it all the time. It doesn't matter if it's a full moon, you can still image your planet. It makes no difference at all. If it's a bit cloudy but there's holes in the cloud, you can still image the planet through the holes. As long as the sky is reasonably clear, you're okay. Absolute cost. From nothing to quite a lot of money. The first image I'll show you in a minute, some equipment. I'll pop forward just momentarily. If you look in this room here, this is this telescope here. This is a 90mm refractor on a hectorid mount with no electronics of any kind, no motors or anything. First images I took of the Moon and Jupiter were taken with that, with a webcam, literally a webcam, with the case pulled off and a nose piece glued to it, stuck in the back of the telescope. And I stood there using the fine detailed cable controls on the side of the telescope mount, tracking by hand. And I got some lovely images of the Moon out of that way. Jupiter was a bit harder with the 90mm refractor because it's kind of too small, but it's still got some quite fun images, but the Moon, amazing images out of that. The one next to it is the current telescope I use, but on its original fork mount. That worked really well. That's more than adequate for anything you do with planets. Fancy equipment is not required.
I'll just go back again.
Can anyone do it? Yes, it's the easiest kind of astroimaging to do, apart from maybe the simplest kind of point and click, pointing single shot DSLR, but you don't need the expensive equipment that you need for good DSLR images. You can use a webcam, literally. Most people buy a small planetary cam because it costs a couple of hundred, $200-$300. You just need a computer, a camera, a USB cable, and some kind of telescope. Almost any kind of telescope will do. It helps if it tracks automatically, but that just is still doing using the Dobsonian. Lots of people do planetary imaging using Dobsonians. In fact, big, long 12-inch Dobsonians do some of the best images. There's a couple of the best astro images out there that are using big Dobsonians to do it. Okay. The theory. I'm going to run through this quite quickly. Obviously, it's kind of boring. So you get a video. How do you turn a video into an image? And are you really producing an image that accurately represents things? Stacking. So, simplest way to put it, you're taking a big stack of images, you're sorting out the good ones, and you're averaging them for a given value of the word average, which is obviously a simple question. You're averaging that and saying, what's the best sort of average across the entire image? And you come up with the final image. People have done it manually and with images stacking in software by themselves, but since the advent of the programs that automatically do the maths, it becomes much more accessible and doesn't take days to process images. The program I use is AutoStackIt. Registax was the most popular program, but is now kind of obsoleted by AutoStackIt, which is a more modern piece of software with better maths. So several steps, it goes through all your images and aligns the object so that it's perfectly aligned in all the images, because you know when you've got a video of something, it's bobbling around all over the place, it's no use doing it. First thing it does, crunches it all together, lines it all up. Then it does an analysis, ranking the images by quality. It uses the software uses a number of different criteria for that, mainly how sharp the gradients of from dark to light on the image are, how sharp the edges of the object are, and it will come to a conclusion about this image. It can get it wrong. We've had a couple of cases. We had a couple of cases when I was doing some imaging for with one of you guys, I can't remember, where there was one image where the camera got knocked and there was a big wiggly line down the middle, and I know you sometimes get the video, and it decided that was a perfect image because it had some lovely sharp lines down it, and that just threw the entire video. So you just have to throw the video away and start again at that point.
You can get the same thing with deep space objects too.
Yes.
Not just the sharp line, but when it bounces, you can actually get to double up on stars and it thinks, oh, there's a lot of stars here,
exactly.
It's really sharp.
You can apply your common sense to what
yeah.
it's doing.
It's fine to stack it there, you can manually reject frames, because I'm pretty sure Registax, if you didn't.
I've never figured out how to do this in AutoStackIt, but I'm pretty sure that it's somewhere in there you can. I actually think it would be really useful. Most of the time, though, I'm stacking as soon as it's come off the camera, so there's plenty of time to just throw a stack away if it's faulty. Yes, and you can use some kind of processing software like Planetary Image Preprocessor, PIP, or several others, which would allow you to go through and crop the video. Let's say at the end of the video, the plant goes out of frame. You could pre-crop the video to lose that bit, so that you can still use the stack.
In my olden days, when I was about 20s or 30s, I used to do astronomical photography myself. And I used to take a series of photos. And analyze when I developed them using the darkroom here, I'd find which one was the best. And that's the same as stacking.
Exactly. So thankfully, the software now makes it so easy to do that you can take thousands of images and have the software do the thinking for you. We're very fortunate. We live in very fortunate days for this kind of stuff. Final step is combination stacking. The images aren't simply averaged together. There's a lot of maths involving the points across a grid of points across the image, which that means the software can pick the best bits from various images. The maths is available out there if anyone's really interested, and I can get some pointers to it, but you've got to really like maths. Wavelets and sharpening. This is where Registax comes in. We've all seen this thing in Registax where you've just wavelets and this beautiful sharp image pops out on the screen. Can you really do that from a blurred image? Most people think of a blurred photograph goes in the bin. Sharpening is a very dangerous, and yes, you can, in fact, and it's mathematically sound. It's based on finding features at certain scales in the image. So you can do a frequency analysis of the image, which says things that are a tenth of the width of Jupiter, I want to emphasize, but things that are very large, like Gaussian blur, I want to de-emphasize. And that's how you get the image. Again, the maths is immensely complicated. Those of you who are into maths can probably find that out. You also do noise reduction at the same time on the same scales. Alternatives to stack images for planetary are to use very large stabilized telescopes with active stabilization and stuff, so you've got a few $1 million, you're good there. Amazing seeing very short exposures. I've taken moon images that are one shots with the SLR plugged into the back of the thing and got images as good as the stuff I've got from stacks just by getting that perfect frame where the scene settled down. Snap. Doesn't happen very often, it's far easier to do it with stacks, far more reliable, but the other images go into orbit and take photos in their atmosphere in the way, but I don't think we're doing that anytime soon. Okay. Equipment required or used. The red stuff is the stuff that matters as such. A telescope. I use a very elderly and very inexpensive old 8-inch Celestron telescope, which you saw in the images, the orange one. That's probably 35 years old, something like that. You can pick them up on TradeMe pretty regularly at quite reasonable prices. And then almost any telescope will do that. But you don't really want a little short Newtonian F4 telescope because the plant's going to be so small. The bigger and the longer, the better, as far as telescope goes. A Barlow is pretty essential to get good images. Some kind of Barlow magnifies the image in the telescope, for anyone who doesn't know. A decent Barlow makes quite a difference. I use a 2x Barlow, a Celestron 2-inch one. It's okay. I'd love to buy a nice PowerMate magnifier and spend $800 on a Barlow type thing and get even better images. But the more you spend, the better it gets, as always with all astronomy, but you don't have to buy expensive equipment.
Difference between a 1.25 and a 2-inch Barlow?
I generally, it's probably not a huge difference. It's a very good 1.25-inch one. The thing with 1.25-inch ones is there's a lot of cheap, nasty barlows around. A 2-inch one is easier to make a good 2-inch barlow than it is to make a 1.25-inch one because the glass is bigger and you're not trying to squeeze as much work into a small thing. But if you've got a good 1.25-inch barlow, that's probably going to work too well. Paired up with the C8, everything 2-inch works really well. But if you've got, whatever's appropriate for you, and what you can get, you work with what you get. But if you're going to use a 1.25 Barlow, the cheap one that came with your telescope that's made of plastic and got 2x written inside of it, not going to make your images better. If you fiber it off, not bothering the Barlow at all, then you can. I tried that when I first got a telescope, it was a disaster.
I'm so sure the 2-inch ones also work pretty well, so ED glass rather than the plain glass, the better quality glass.
Yeah.
And the 1.25-inch ones, the because you've got 2x and 3x, which are acromats, and the 2.5 and 5x are acromats, so an extra lens in them.
Yes. I mean, if you spend a lot of money, you can get 1.25-inch ones from the PowerMates and things like that are amazing. But they're $1,000 a shop kind of money, and you'd up, you've got to be real keen.
Oh, the Astron's the ones I should give a try.
Yeah.
Like your five times, for instance.
Five times is asking an awful lot of your telescope.
Yeah.
In my opinion, but there are, if you've got a really good scope, it's probably worth a go.
The Astron's 2.5, that's a
good
one.
Popular one, yeah.
I use a 2, but that's because that's what I have to own, and I'm top 50. I don't like spending money, or my girlfriend doesn't like spending too much money. Dew heater of some kind is absolutely essential. Your telescope is going to dew up if you don't do anything about it. Every time it gets cold, you get late, and once it's dewed up, you're done for the night, really.
Mm-hmm.
So spend a bit of money, or make a dew heater. I made my own dew heater straps by buying this stuff from JCar Electronics, buying resistor wire and this kind of stuff. It's not hard, but it's easier to buy one if you're not keen on making stuff. Dew shield's nice if you need one, depending on the kind of telescope you've got. If you've got a Newtonian, that's relevant. But if you've got a Schmidt Cassegrain, it's pretty much essential.
Yeah.
You can actually get by without a dew heater if you've got a good dew shield sometimes, because
mm-hmm.
it does most of the work.
Yeah. With my Schmidt Cassegrain, which I used to have, an 8-inch Schmidt,
yeah.
I made a cardboard dew tube.
Yeah,
my
dew shield made out of a bit of foam rubber.
And painted it black paint on the inside and multicolour on the outside.
Yeah.
And it was as long as it's twice the length of, round about the same size or twice the length of your own telescope.
Mm.
It works.
Yeah, until it eventually the cardboard probably gets a bit soggy, but you can just make it off.
That's if you paint it the right way, but it'll last you as long as the telescope itself.
Focuser, I have a very simple electric focuser, one of those that just literally left and right on the button. That's, if you're doing this sort of stuff over a long-term basis, do yourself a favour. Get some kind of focuser, because trying to manually focus a telescope can be quite hard. Because you move the you nudge the telescope and you touch the focuser,
mm-hmm.
And it wobbles and it's hard to focus. Camera, I use what's called a QXY 5P2, courtesy of Andrew and Astron's, which is an inexpensive camera made specifically for this kind of stuff. You can use a converted webcam, but these days with the planetary cameras being not much more expensive than webcams, you'd have to wonder why.
Mm-hmm.
I will show you the camera actually.
Now. Sure.
This is my 2-year time follow. That's my size from 2.5. That's the camera. As you can see, it's very conveniently designed because it's exactly the same size as a 2-inch eyepiece. So it just literally, 1.25-inch eyepiece. So it literally just goes in instead of the eyepiece.
Mm.
That's it. You can adjust how far in it goes, and adjust the ring to, which will adjust the magnification slightly. You can make very fine adjustment to the magnification to get the best point for your telescope. Again, it's an experimentation on that basis. I'm going to set somewhere that seems to work pretty well for me. That's the Barlow I got. It came with an eyepiece kit, 2-inch eyepiece kit. Looks pretty nicely. I just keep those together because I don't trust the Barlow for anything else.
How much is the camera?
That camera is a QXY
5P2.
$399. There you go. Andrew will give you a discount if you ask him really nice. that's a USB 2. Again, that just depends on the camera. There are an endless variety of cameras out there, and very few people here have got cameras that are other manufacturers I know. It doesn't make a huge amount of difference, but they all have their own characteristics. I'm only familiar with the QHY, I'm not familiar with the ZWO, I'm not familiar with the gain settings and all these kinds of things. The cameras are probably completely different across manufacturers. You can also use a monochrome camera with filters, which will give you some nice images. They're just very different imaging. Computer is a completely standard Windows PC. I use an old PC that was in the house that somebody had their PC replaced. I stuck a big SSD drive in it because the speed of the camera writing to the hard drive and you can record your videos is the single biggest barrier to performance. Therefore, an SSD writes incredibly quickly and you get the full frame rate. I also control my mount from the computer, but that's just convenience really, and the fact that the mount can do it. My mount is a Sculptor EQ6 Pro, which is just a fairly standard mount, one of the most popular mounts out there. That's it up there, just aboard it. This is it inside my home observatory. It's just stuck on a homemade pedal. It's the plug into the computer, very simple go-to mount, which I guess most people have got some kind of go-to telescope these days. If you haven't, you can use a manual telescope, it will work. But go-to saves you huge amounts of time, of course. Software used. Catherine's offer, I use Sharp Cap, which is still free if you use Google 9. He's gone to the next version has gone to a subscription model, but it's so much better than anything else I've seen that I'm just kind of anyway. You can use other alternatives. FireCap is very popular, easy kind of tricking through some cameras. They're variously good and bad for different reasons. I highly recommend SharpCap just because it's just so fully featured for this kind of stuff. And it's also can be used for long exposure stuff, should you wish. And it's getting more and more featured as it goes. For stacking enhancement, I use AutoStackIt 2, which is comfortably the easiest and best thing to use. I use Registack 6 for sharpening and colour adjustment afterwards, because AutoStackIt doesn't do those things. Doesn't try to do those things, they decide not to bother and leave it to register. Interesting, I use Photoshop, that's because I have Photoshop, so. If you don't have Photoshop, you can get GIMP or any image processing program that can handle 32-bit TIFFs and all this kind of stuff can be used. On any computer, anything can do that. It's the least important part of the process is the post processing in terms of planetary stuff. Capture process. First thing is plan. What are you going to photograph? What's up there? When's it up there? Etc. Any of your home planetarium programs, Stellarium, Cartesian, etc., will all allow you to see exactly where all the planets are at any given time of night. Also, there's endless charts online showing you what times of the year planets are going to be up. For instance, at the moment, Jupiter is up high in the evening, Saturn is up high later at night, and that's pretty much your life at the moment. At various times of the month, you get Mercury and Venus at low altitudes, which you can have a go. Mars is not there this year at all, but next year is exceptional for Mars. Next year should be, anyone who's really keen on planetary energy, make sure you really just go for the middle of next year, because Mars is going to be even better than it was a few years ago, apparently. So that's going to be great. Mars is, in some ways, the nicest thing to image if you've got at a good time. What interesting stuff is happening when? It's actually interesting stuff happens to these various planets. Jupiter especially is dependent on this. You also see the images with transits of moons going across and all kinds of stuff. And when with Jupiter, you want to know, when's it going to have the red spot facing us? You don't want to go out and get set up, and you point in an hour, and it's the backside of Jupiter with very relatively few features, no moons in the image. It can get a little dull after a few sessions. So it's nice to plan. There are Saturn will vary in the angle of the rings. They're very good at the moment. A few years ago, it was basically a straight line with the planet, which didn't make for the best imaging ever.
It's exceptional at the moment.
It is
very exceptional.
Yes.
Yes,
of course.
For Jupiter, I don't remember for Saturn, but for Jupiter, because of rotation, it's good to take within 8 minutes.
That's right, we've got a list of those.
Yeah.
No, it's a good point because it is a very important point about how long it takes to get. Altitude of the planet, it's nice to try and make sure it's as high as possible in your imaging. If it's just above the tree line, you're going to struggle because you're going through more atmosphere, there's going to be more spectral split, you're going to have red and blue fringes, you're going to have lots of noise. Later at night's better because everything gets colder and people's houses cool down and people's roads cool down and all these things that anyway. Heat is your enemy, basically. Hot air ruins everything. Sometimes you can't help it. Sometimes you happen to be looking at Jupiter over a bunch of houses and you just have to roll with it, which I think is Kevin's problem, isn't it? You're quite,
I've got motorway and a bridge nearby.
Exactly. But you make the best of it. And later at night it gets better and better, doesn't it? So, you know, by the time it's 2 a.m, it's actually quite respectable, even regardless of what's on the ground. If you've got a lovely view out over the ocean or something, then great. multiple sessions for planning to do videos and stuff. If anyone here has any other experience or ideas on that subject, I'd like to talk to them at some point, and maybe we talk about planning some video. When I say videos, I mean recording lots of frames and putting them back together into time capture videos of Jupiter rotating, Mars rotating, all this. That once you've got the image quality to a certain point, that starts to be very attractive, but that's a long project over many nights to get really good.
Yeah, Firecapture allows you to do that. I've done a couple of time lapses.
What does?
Firecapture allows you to do multiple recordings at whatever timings you want.
Yeah, SharpCap's got a similar feature. I've only played very lightly with it. My problem is, once I've got all these captured images, a good process for turning those into usable, high-quality output video that's stable is something I haven't got a lot of knowledge of. So somebody who has would be a really useful partner.
Just the one thing you could try for that is to catch a lunar libration. The trouble is you need a lot, if you do it in 1 month, you need to be lucky with a lot of clear nights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you know, yeah, whenever the moon's at least half full, that's when you get clear nights, isn't it? Mm-hmm. We'll know that one. Okay, we're out. Preparation. Okay, so before you start imaging anything, set up your equipment. Couple of useful things. Get your finoscope or whatever finder you use aligned as accurate with your telescope as you can. Get a nice narrow eyepiece in there, find some bright star, try and centre the finder as exactly as you can, because it will make it a hell of a lot easier to find the planet later, because you can find it through the finder and it'll be in the middle of the camera. When I first started, I spent whole nights just trying to get Jupiter into the camera and went to bed frustrated many times, especially when I had the manual telescope. Trying to record a focus point. If you use your telescope for other things and you also use it for this, you'll find that the focus point required for the camera is quite different than the focus point you need for eyepieces or for an SLR or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
If you've got some way of recording, by marking the tube or whatever, where the focus is when you've got your camera focused, do so, because another night you can just go to that point and you're almost there and you're just left with fine focusing. Because you've got a combination of things to find. You've got to obtain your target and you've got to get in focus. So it's quite hard. You're going to try and find a target that's out of focus is hard, because all you end up with a big faint ring, an out of focus image in the telescope looks like. That can be handy because it's much bigger, but it's very faint. So I'll show you that on a video in a little while. Finding your target, getting a preview is one of the hardest bits. Once you've got the point where you know Jupiter's in your frame, you're halfway to having output. Focusing. Initial focus can be tricky, as I said, when capturing the full field. So basically you set your capture software to capture as wide a field as possible on screen. You try and centre the object and get a rough focus. I'll show you that on the video because it's quite interesting. You then go to a narrower view that's more like what you're going to want to actually capture and get the focus refined. That's very important, but not that hard, to be honest. I'll show you some more of that rather than talking about it. Okay, examples of things during focus prep. Hopefully this isn't going to start blaring my voice like that, because nobody wants that. Right, here you can see this is Sharpcat, that's Jupiter. Very out of focus, but it allows you to see where that's roughly in the screen. You can see the centre of Jupiter's up here somewhere because of the ring there. And once we bring it into focus, we're going to see it a lot better, hopefully. Can I show you that video? That's me playing with the focuser, and it starts to move it. I'll move on to the next video because that's not really good. Here I've come in a little closer to focus. And I can then, what I'm going to do, what I'll do when I've got it this close is I've got a video game controller hooked up, connected to the software on the computer that controls the telescope. So I can use the motion controls on there to move around. See, I can move it into the centre of the frame.
That's good idea.
The dust bunnies aren't as bad as that, really, honest. They look like when it's completely out of focus. And also it's, I did this very quickly at 6:30 in the evening, so this is pretty crappy, but. You can see, I bring it into the frame, and then I'll be able to get into a proper focus. Here, I've gone about as far as I'm going to go on focus at wide field. You can see I've got it down to a small ball, so I've got it really close. Over here, I've just come in here to say, you can see I'm looking at a very long exposure. It's 200 milliseconds. That allowed you to see the defocused image, out of the full frame for the camera. In Sharpcat, you can say how much of the camera you want to actually capture. So I start off capturing all of it. I've turned down the exposure, you'll start to see, this, again, it doesn't show up well in this video, but you can see the wings at that point a little bit, just to see the bands, just to see. And you see all the moons as well. I think up here, that's probably Ganymede. And there's some bat stripes, so we know we're reasonably close. I can then come in here, and I think here I go. Yeah, you can see we change our change to capture area, to 800 by 600, which is more like what I want to capture. And boom, there it is. It's now showing what I'm capturing, and there, and I can refine the focus at that point, which I probably proceed to do here. I'm not sure. Sorry, this is my phone held in one hand, capturing the video while I'm.
I've been taking to making the exposure a little bit higher than that, and using one of the moons as a focus point.
Yeah.
Because you get the flaring when it's out of focus, and then it comes down into a dot.
Yeah. Now, as far as focus aids go, a program like Sharp Eye has several focus aids, which are program things on the menu you can turn on that help you focus. They show, they'll show different patterns on screen that assist with finding gradients, finding little graphs that show you in focus. They're hard to use on planets, I find. I personally find it's easier to focus just by watching the thing and focusing until the features are as sharp as possible. But a lot of people do use it. A lot of people also use backlog masks, things like that. Again,
the masks are harder.
I honestly think, for me, because I've got quite a stable telescope, I can focus with the hand controller, it's easier to focus by looking at the, just by looking as closely as you can at the image and just tweaking until you see the features pop out as best as possible. Other people's mileage probably varies there, though. Okay, capturing. Very important, possibly one of the most important things is getting the exposure and gain settings right for your camera and the object you're looking at. I try and go for as low gain as possible. I don't know if you know anything about electronic gain in cameras. It allows you to boost the image at the expense of noise. You can't go for no gain at all. You just get no image. For me, on Jupiter, I'm usually roughly around 25 milliseconds exposure and 9 gain. I see other people using other brands of camera who have completely different results. So you really have to experiment with your camera and also look online. Saturn is duller than Jupiter. It's no near as bright, but it's bigger and sharper, so it's a higher exposure. Possibly even 40 might be a bit low for Saturn, depends on your telescope. Mars is so variable depending on how far away it is. Its distance from us varies so much that when Mars is far away, you've got to really amp it up. When it's very close, it's actually very bright. So Mars is surprisingly bright because it's so small and bright, you can actually get away with quite short exposures. The moon, very short exposures. The most important thing with the moon is not to have too much, is not to have all those, you know, you see all those moon images where the crater tips are all bright white and flare, you know, blown out? That's the worst thing to do with moon images because it's all lost picture. So moon, super low exposures. Capture parameters for your video. The size of the frame, again, is whatever's going to allow you to keep that planet in frame for the length of the video. As small as you can get the frame size for the video is better because your videos are smaller, or literally smaller on disk, but you've got to be able to keep the thing in the frame. If your setup is quite stable, it's not that hard. I mean, Jupiter, it's reasonably easy, but you know, it can be difficult. Early days of when you want to do the manual thing, that was the hardest thing.
Ultimate test of drift alignment.
Yeah, pretty much. Though you're only honestly, 2 minute capture on Jupiter, if it's reasonably well set up, you don't need to touch it. You just leave it and it'll sit there in the frame. So that's always nice if it does that. Jupiter, you can only take quite a short exposure because it rotates remarkably quickly. It's 8 hours, I think, for a full rotation. And it's surprising how quickly that means that things move noticeably. If things rotate noticeably over the length of your video, then that's going to be smeared out across the stacked image and you'll lose all the detail. 1.5 is probably the nicest length for a Jupiter image, I think. Video, 2 is acceptable. Anything over 2, you're really doing yourself out of a good image. It's a balance between wanting more frames and wanting it as steady as possible. I'll mention the rotation shortly. Saturn, you can go longer, partly because it doesn't rotate as fast and partly because it doesn't really matter if it rotates a bit because most of the detail is in bands anyway. There isn't really, unlike Jupiter where you have all this dots and detail, you don't have that on Saturn. So unless you're at really high resolutions, a little bit of rotation below on Saturn is not actually going to be visible in your final image. But you know, it shouldn't be huge long videos because you're going to end up with something that doesn't really look like real footage. Mars, again, a bit longer than Jupiter.
Mm.
I think it's about 4 minutes.
Do you do primary or eyepiece projection?
Primary, absolutely.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, you this is just mounted at the prime focus. Anything else with these little cameras, there's no real reason to do anything else because it doesn't have a lens. It's you know, it, but it, of course it depends on your telescope. Some people's telescopes can't do it and you have to use IP projection. There's no reason, it wouldn't really cause you any problems if you can get the focal length right. The moon, doesn't matter how long you take it really, it's not going to change noticeably over a video you take over a few minutes. The moon's going to change that rapidly, isn't it? Though I'm sure technically it does. Derotation is an incredibly clever thing people came up with, where you can take either a long video or multiple videos, and using mathematics and some kind of internal map of Jupiter in the software, it will actually derotate the images so they all lined up perfectly with each other, so it doesn't matter how long your video is. I'm not too sure about it myself. I feel that it sounds a bit like the software's drawing pictures for you, because it's based on the software knowing what the features on Jupiter are like. And so, you know, but the best images do use it, because if you're using very high resolution telescopes, very high resolution cameras and getting, then you start to get not to be able to take long enough sequences to do the job. There's probably a program called WinJupos, which is worth looking at if you get serious. You know, it's very popular and used by people like Damien, use it, I believe, I'm sure he does. And their images are amazing, so I wouldn't say that if he was at this talk. image movement centering, I'm assuming at this point you've got some kind of telescope that's got a motor, so you've got a handset that lets you go, you know, north, south, east, west. Set it to its slowest setting, and while you're watching the thing capturing, you can just nudge. And that little bit of nudge where the planet goes like this around the frame while you're nudging it doesn't have any effect on the output at all. So you just basically just got to keep it in frame, as little movement as possible. That'll be good. Shelf screen examples during capture. So what I'm looking at here, that's set to 1.5 minutes. I've said go capture, 1.5 minutes, go. Down here you can see, you can't see probably, obviously if I don't like it. Yeah, you can actually, can't you? You can see I've captured 2,600 frames in 1 minute 21 seconds at 32 frames a second, so it's pretty bad at that point, I'm not sure why. You can find your frame rates going up and down depending on your computer behaviour and stuff. There's a few settings in here which I can provide some kind of guide on sharp cap settings if, on paper at some point if people would like it, which helped with a few tweaks, because as you saw with there's a few little tricks. They aren't they going to, because nobody can remember them if I just say them. Yeah, so that's what's capturing away. That's actually me just playing the video. You can see the videos there. I've actually got, I think, here. Yeah, that's a. There we go. That's actually a video. This was taken at 6:30 in the evening, so it's pretty terrible. But you can see it's not that bad. You can see features, you can see the gambling properly sitting next to it.
You can tell from the telescope.
There's also something you can tell, something that is probably quite interesting. There's a quick little note here about the output from something like SharpCap. SharpCap's very handy. These are where it outputs the video to a folder. It also outputs a text file next to each video. In that text file are all the parameters you use to take the video. So it's worth keeping with your videos, because later on, 6 months later, you can go back and see exactly what your exposures were set to, how long the video, all these things. That's quite useful. One little thing to note about this video is Jupiter's a bit small in this video. If I go back to my equipment photographs, which took the same night, any of you smart people tell me what I did wrong when I was taking the video at 6:30 in the evening and quickly for you guys. No? Nothing strange about my image path?
You got the focal reducer?
This is a focal reducer, which I left on the telescope after doing normal deep sky astronomy. I then put the image is reduced by two-thirds of what it should be. Normally I wouldn't have a focal reducer on for my image. It does. It actually makes it easier to focus when you get a sharper image, but it's smaller than the last thing you want. It's smaller images. Okay, probably running a bit slow here, aren't I? We then have a video. Once we have a video, we want to stack it. So what do we do? We load the image into auto-stack it, we analyse it, we set up alignment points, we set the stacking parameters, and frame selection, and then we stack it. This is auto-stack it. I have everything set up on here that allow me to run an actual do a stack for you at the end if we've got time. I don't know what time it is.
3 minutes.
Huh?
3 minutes.
No, right, we're running through the time clock. Okay. So, okay, we're going to, this is AutoStacker. I've loaded the image into AutoStacker. I've clicked open here, load image. I've then clicked analyze. Now, there's a few different variations of what you can do with analysis. You can choose, if it's a surface like the moon, you choose surface analysis because it uses different math for it. If it's a very small planet, you choose edge because it's easier for it to detect sharp edges. If you use a live planet with lots of features, you choose gradient because it's easier for it to find the quality frame by how sharply defined those features are. I click analyze, you can see it produces a graph here. It's not a particularly impressive graph, but this point here is the sort of image is being okay. Everything above this middle line is respectable, everything below it is terrible. So you can see you've got some quite good images up here in this first quarter. I'm sorry, I'll just turn it off. Okay, what was I saying? Okay, we've then got the alignment points. You can see on here a grid of little boxes all over the image. Now this is, I've done this the easy way. I've set this to the smallest alignment size and said place grid. And it covers the visible object and its found Ganymede with alignment points. To get the very best results, ideally you should do these at least partially by hand, because the people who make the software say what you want around the edge, where you've got not so many features, but you're an edge, you want larger boxes. The idea is all the boxes will overlap anyway. But you know, you want, so there's lots of guides online to how to get the best alignment points, but that will produce good images just using the grid. I can then come in here, and you can see here you've got four of these. You can say I want to take final capture an image at 20% of the frames, 40% of the frames, 10% of the frames. You can set to four of these. It will do the stack and it will output four images of the different things just to save time from doing it again. There's a few other little features here about sharpening and stuff, which you know, you all do as you experiment. I then press the stack and it goes boom and does the magic thing.
More critical than the frames.
We can then, right, before we go to wavelets, I will just pop through to here. So you can just see what this is, the app from AutoStacker. Doesn't look very impressive, it just looks like a much less noisy version of what you had on the screen, but in actual fact, it's done quite a lot of work for it. At that point, if I go back a couple of frames now, we're going into Registax. We take our image and we're going to do the wavelet sharpening. So we load the image into Registax. We do several steps here are really useful. RGB alignment. Usually you're going to find on your images that red, green, blue are slightly out of line with each other. You see little coloured fringes around things. There's an RGB alignment function here which allows you to take that out. Very useful indeed. It does it automatically. You put a box around the whole planet and say go, and it finds it. The histogram is allows you to basically stretch out the image across the brightness. And probably you can do that in Photoshop afterwards if you want, but it's quite handy to do it here. Colour balance, it also does auto colour balance, which lets you find a slightly better, because usually your camera and telescope combination is going to give it too much red or too much green or whatever. It's a bit, obviously you fiddle around the colour balance is a little bit artistic, but in actual fact you are looking at a real object and you can go to reference and see what colour Jupiter should be and bring your image into balance with it. Noise reduction and sharpening, noise reduction is also available in there. So sharpening with the wavelets is, wavelets. Now wavelets is really what Registax is all about. At the left side here you'll see a bunch of sliders. I'll stand over here. They're basically these represent different images, different scales of detail on the image. Starting with very small detail, up to much larger detail. You have a slider here, which allows you to say how much enhancement you want to apply at that level. Generally you apply more at the smaller level, and less as you get bigger, otherwise you end up with some very strange images. There's these controls in here, control how strongly this is applied, and that's right, they apply, it's the maths is kind of confused this one. But, and this one here, how much noise reduction is applied at that level, which is very important. I've got, you can see here, I've got a line where I've got lots at the lowest level coming down, nothing at the high level, because you just, you find that the image, you end up with those images that have got really bold fringes around the outside, they can end up a terrible mess. There's a wavelet panel which allows you to automatically set these basic parameters using a step value, so it's worth setting it so it goes 1, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, whatever. And that just automatically populates it, and then you move these slides around, find what works for you. I can provide some basic profiles for this. You can save your profile. I have basic profiles for Jupyter saved that are going to work for like a starting point, but there really is no solid answer for what's going to work for you, apart from the fact that you're working at the lower scales. The bigger scale sliders are pretty much useless to you, apart from the most subtle tiny amounts. You'll find that you do the moon, you end up with a quite different profile. I think otherwise, if you use these low profiles very high on the moon, you end up with a massive noise. So, okay, we come out of Registax, we then have an output, which we then take into our image processing and do the obvious thing. It comes out as a 32-bit TIFF, which is no use to anybody. You're going to want to convert it into an 8-bit JPEG so that you can use it in web browsers and anything else. RGB alignment. And again, it depends on your image processing software, you can have very fine control of that kind of thing, and fine control of curves and stuff. You can make sure the background is dead black in Photoshop or whatever. You can do more noise reduction and sharpening. A very useful trick here is, it depends on your software, but if you're in Photoshop, is to look at the three channels separately. You can see it, you can actually quite well here. The blue channel, for instance, you see it's noisy as anything. It always is. It's something to do with the camera guys and the way the light scattered in the atmosphere, I think. Blue channel always has it noisy, so it's worth doing more noise reduction on blue than any other channels. If you just go in noise reduction, it applies to all the channels, and your lovely sharp red channel that doesn't really have anything doing to it ends up getting over sharpened. So you can go in, sharpen the blue channel a bit, but again, it depends on your software and your preference. So a bit of noise reduction, a bit of sharpening on the channels there, and that's showing the combination of those three. The next one, you can see quite clearly the progression. That's coming out of Auto Packet, that's what Registax produced, and that's a quick Photoshop. Now this was a really bad image. It's with the focal reducer in at 6:30 in the evening, lots of atmospheric noise, and yet it's still fairly respectable, really. And you've got your little reflect at the bottom of it. Another example, that's probably a rather better example that I've created previously. What I like about this is it shows you the left picture is what you're seeing on screen, whilst once you've got the camera connected to the telescope and it's live, it looks like that. So if your camera image looks like that, you're going to get images like that. That's the progression you can expect. So you can get a pretty good idea when you're capturing of how good it's going to be. And if you're not seeing some bit of detail on those clouds and stuff, then you probably need to adjust something or accept it's a bad night. Some nights, for no apparent reason, the seeing is just useless. Just have to suck it up and go another night. It's really nice to try and find transits. That's up there, the IO, I think. Bumming across IO's shadow. I think it's IO's shadow. I can't remember. This is a long time ago. But you can see the shadow of the planet there. It makes it really easy to focus when you've got something like a planet shadow to look at, because you can see it coming into focus. The other most important thing to avoid with your exposures is nothing on this should be white when you're capturing it. It's better to underexpose a little bit than overexpose. So when you're setting that exposure time on your camera, you better go a little dark and a little light, because once you blow out the image, once you go too bright and it starts flaring out, nothing is ever going to get the detail back. Whereas if you're underexposed a little bit, yeah, it's better not to, better to get it right, but you can bring that detail back out. Well, we've got a couple more slides. These are just examples. These are probably some of my nicest ones. That's definitely IO, because you can see IO right next to its shadow, which was highly unusual. That was taken at opposition. That was in one night from opposition, which is why the planet's right next to its shadow. Obviously, the sun's behind us, ours, Jupyter, so you've got a shadow going straight through. It's always nice to get the great red spot on things, because that gives you something that's in detail. It's especially nice if you can see, like here, you can see some of the detail in the spot. You can see a little bit of these on millions of ring around. That's when you know you've got it right, and you start seeing those little bits of detail come out.
the, that's just examples of good and bad. They're not, that's reasonable percent, I think, for an ancient telescope. You can't really see things like the hexagon at the pole. Bigger telescopes really needed for that. But maybe one day I'll get one where I can see the hexagon and pole and confident.
Anyone saw the hexagon until Cassini did.
Yeah, but once you know it's there, you can see it. And if you do an 11-inch telescope, you can definitely get it on your images. I've seen heaps of stuff coming through it on. It's as much about colour balance than getting it right. The only risk with Saturn, it's very easy to overprocess your images of Saturn because they look better and better and better, and then you realise the reason it's so sharp is because I've just overprocessed the hell out of it. You know, there's a little band of transparency here, which is nice to keep. If you start losing that, you probably overprocessed it. These are the bottom of the bag. They were taken one night as an experiment. It's the only time I've been able to get Venus from where my telescope sits, which is why I did it. I got Venus, Mars, Saturn in one night. But they're all pretty bad because it was a terrible the moon. I haven't talked much about the moon, which is a shame because it's actually really nice to image. If you can get around about the half moon period or either side of it, there's some lovely images of the moon. Once you get to full moon, don't waste your time unless you like white things.
You always have a look around the edges, I suppose.
You can, and people who are very, very geeky about the moon can find something at any time, but me, it's boring stuff, full moon. This is quite a nice little image of the, this here was called something, my
rail.
Just done
It's some sort of rail.
Yeah, but it's the most famous of the, it's the most famous of the battles on the moon, which I know all about, and have written stuff about, and can't remember any. But that sort of was very nice. The next one is probably my best moon image, I think, which I spent a lot of time trying not to do what the other one shows a little bit of, which is not to overblow any of the highlights and just get that perfect point. This is an unusual area of the moon as well. It's not unusual a lot, so it was quite fun to do it. This is actually multiple images. This is like a bunch of multiple images composed together. I think it came together really nicely. But with the moon, there's so much you can do, like getting the subtle surface detail out. That's so much more interesting than just craters. There's so much more going on the moon than that. And there's a lot to see. So it's nice with the moon to go and find out what you're looking at afterwards. Take your image and go to get the lunar mapping software you can download and just try and find what name of the craters in your image are. It's quite an interesting thing to do. Useful software downloads. Also stacked it. I've included links I can provide this stuff. I'll probably put some of this stuff up on the website. Where you can download various bits of software. If you've got a sculpture mount, you can use EQ Mod, which is just invaluable. Transform astronomy, it really does. Those kind of programs, or EQ Mod, or equivalents for other equipment around there, I'm sure. There's some nice websites that allow you to look at that project. Pluto will show you what time moon occlusion is going to happen exactly, so you can plan what time's a good time to be out there looking. You can have your telescope ready and imaging just as Io crosses the edge of Jupiter. You get a beautiful image just of the shadow cutting into the side of Jupiter, all this kind of stuff, you know. Cal Sky is a nice site that lets you.
Last Saturday, Europa was actually going through, occult Jupiter.
Yeah.
It's very close.
If you can get it right. And the occlusions are quite nice as well, and the planet moon's going behind, if you can just get it at the right moment, you get some nice images out of that as well,
I didn't get, I don't have a camera, but I used to do astronomical photography a long time ago.
Yeah, I know you did.
So I'm learning about this digital stuff.
How easy it is now, compared to what you used to do. Cal Sky is useful, it allows you to go, show me exactly what Jupiter will look like at a particular time, with a particular time of telescope or a particular location on the Earth, and it'll show you a beautiful image of exactly what you can expect to see. So you can plan things to a T. And WinJupos, which, again, I don't use, but it's quite important.
Could you tell me what EQ Mod does?
EQ Mod is a system for controlling your telescope mount. So you plug your mount in via a USB cable to the computer, you load it with EQ Mod, you don't have the handset plugged into the telescope at all. You use it instead of the handset. But it allows you to control things infinitely. It allows you to do periodic error correction. It also allows you to load some like Carte de Cielo or Stellarium. And I can go into Stellarium, say, P
pick something in Stellarium, press Control 1, and the telescope will fall into the object.
Can you do your
two-star
alignment with that?
Yes, you can plot on that. It does all the alignment stuff.
Uh-huh.
So you can use, you can go around a bunch of objects, align them perfectly, and store all the alignment points in EQ mod across the entire sky. It's just the same thing they do with the sky. The professional guys use the sky in the same way. EQ mod is like a open source way that lets you do it with your amateur mount. It lets you do all the same stuff without spending all the money. And it's tremendous. I'm currently at about 5 minutes from getting off from a desk in the house to having the camera imaging an object. Okay, it's still too warm at that point, but you know, that's how quickly I can go out, slide the roof off, press go and everything, tell them to connect, choose an object, slew, image.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about 5 minutes. It's that easy. Obviously, if you're going to carry a telescope outside, it's never going to be that easy. Because
yeah.
You're going to have to polar align it every
thing
time.
Knows, EQ mounts are a bit heavy.
We'll have to do a session on polar alignment sometime and for all the methods, because that's everybody's challenge, isn't it?
Mm.
I don't think really got time to go through any actual processing. These are a couple of videos of. Okay. Is that not mirroring? How do I get that to mirror? There you go. These are a couple of decent videos. You can see the fairly given a red spot there. It's not too bad. This other one is probably better. Oh, sorry, I don't have a screen control or back of the screen. This is one that produced some exceptionally nice images.
Oh, there's a moon at the side.
You can see the moon. This is the moon just crossed. Didn't we know? This sequence produced a really, really nice image. So
you were right when you said before, some nights you can see it and it looks clear visually.
Yep.
But trying to get it on camera, it is just keeps going out and out of focus so fast.
Absolutely.
That you just cannot get a nice
image. I think that. That is the image from that video. That's probably one of my nicest images. I really like that. That's Ganymede, actually, I believe, transiting, which is why you can see all the detail on the moon, because Ganymede's big enough to show some detail.
What about the white dots?
Yes. Yeah, the storm patterns in the clan, they're always there, they just vary in just how prominent they are. That was an exceptional night, and I was really pleased with that. That's a lovely image. It was one of the nicest. I've taken hundreds and hundreds of images, of course, over time. And yeah, they vary in.
Sort of with borrowing a webcam and giving it a go.
Absolutely. Totally is.
You did those with the same webcam, or was that?
No, these are the digital ones taken with the digital Canon DSLR plugged into the same telescope for the most part.
And
some accessories, got an M83, our favourite southern thing. That's plugging that hydrogen alpha filter into the same telescope sequence.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably that. I actually like the Mars images, probably the best. Mars images are kind of my favourite. That was at Mars opposition last year when it was so amazing. And that, I was so thrilled to see the cloud, the poles and stuff. That was kind of one of those, oh my god, I can't believe I just did that moments. Yeah, I was hoping I'd have time to do a little bit of a look at running something into AutoStacker, but I think realistically we have to probably accept I don't have time for that.
We're just about that.
Yeah.
Can we do it another night?
I can bring my laptop to another session, and when somebody's finished talking, we can do a quick run through. Or I can run through it with anyone who wants to have a run through, because I've got the videos and the program on
there. Tell you what.
Just so you can see what it actually looks like doing this.
Yeah.
Registax especially, because you get.
How long will it take you?
I don't know.
Sean.
5-10 minutes.
Okay. Because what I'm thinking is that I'm not sure how. My one with Maxim might only take about half an hour,
yeah.
So you want to go after that?
Yeah, exactly.
Month?
We could do that.
I
just have to bring my laptop and then we can do it.
Okay.
So that's pretty much my process, and that's the kind of stuff I've been able to do using the equipment that I didn't buy specifically for the purpose apart from the camera. It was just the telescope I happened to own. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, thank
you
very much for that.
One question, Danny.
When you have time,
yeah.
or
Before to go to auto stacker, use PIPD, splitting frames will be already arranged in order of quality. The diagram will be almost smooth.
Yeah, you can pre-process it carefully. I found it's not, given the relatively short videos and I'm keeping the thing in center all the time, it's not. But if you've got any problems with your videos, absolutely PIPP is a tremendously useful tool. I should have listed it in the software because you can take a video and say, I want to crop that time out, I want to adjust the size of it, I want to do all kinds of stuff with it. The important thing about videos, by the way, is uncompressed video. You've got to capture uncompressed video. There's no good capturing an MP4 file. It's just going to be useless. You've got to capture uncompressed AVIs from your camera.
Okay, well, I think
one more question.